Hey guys, how are you? Welcome to GeoMind, and in today's video we will start the part 7 of optical mineralogy. And in this video we will discuss the interference figures of uniaxial minerals. Alright, so under this topic we will discuss the optic axis figure, flash figure, then we will discuss sign of elongation and the important part, that is determination of optic sign. Alright, so if you are new to the channel, please subscribe, like and share this video because it always motivates me and helps me to create new content for you guys. Okay, so also if you want the PDF of this lecture, you can join my Telegram group. I have given the link in the description below. Okay, so let's just take a brief view of the topics that I have already covered, already discussed, okay, and made the videos about. So I have discussed about anisotropic, isotropic minerals, that how we identify between these two minerals, okay, using the petrological microscope. Then we have discussed the extinction, type of extinction. We have discussed interference colors. We have discussed the birefringence. Okay, this twinning topic, I will make a separate video on that twinning itself. And these three topics I will be covering today for uniaxial, okay. And for biaxial, there will be separate video for these topics, okay, for the interference figure. Talking about the PPL, we have discussed the color, we have discussed relief, okay, how we use Becquerel line and oblique illumination method. Then we have discussed twinkling and refractive index, okay, how we measure the refractive index of the mineral. The left out topics, that is cleavage, pleochroism, pleochroic hollows, will be covered in a separate video. All right, so let's talk about interference figures. So interference figures provide the basis for determining whether an anisotropic mineral is uniaxial or biaxial. Okay, so using interference figures we determine whether an anisotropic mineral, okay, that is a birefringent mineral, okay, is a uniaxial mineral or a biaxial mineral. Now I am assuming that you already know what is uniaxial and biaxial. I will not be discussing it, okay. If you don't know what it is, you can watch my previous videos on optical mineralogy, okay. So that will give you a basic idea about what is uniaxial and biaxial. So interference figures are important for distinguishing between uniaxial and biaxial, and also determining the optic sign of these uniaxial and biaxial minerals. Okay, so what your typical interference figures look like. So this figure you see here is a uniaxial interference figure, optic axis interference figure for a uniaxial mineral. Okay, so it looks like a circle and it is observed under the polarizing microscope, obviously. Okay, so it has a black cross, you can see here. Okay, so this black cross is called isogyre. Then we have a center which is black, extinct, we call it a melotope. And then we have these lines here, circular rings here, okay, and these rings are colored rings, we call them isochromes. Okay, now how melotope, how isogyre and isochromes are created, we will discuss it in detail. Okay, so this is your uniaxial optic axis figure. Okay, now why we are calling it optic axis, we will discuss it. Then we have your biaxial optic axis figure and it looks like this. So you can clearly distinguish between the two. Okay, now this is for the example and we will discuss it in detail. Okay, so the following procedure is used to obtain an interference figure. So how we use the petrological microscope in order to find or observe the uniaxial interference figure. Okay, so first we have to focus on a mineral grain with high power objective lens. Okay, now if you haven't watched the petrological microscope video, I highly suggest you to watch it, because in that video I have discussed the all components of your petrological microscope and what are their uses. Okay, so you can watch it later. Flip in the auxiliary condenser. Okay, so your auxiliary condenser is there in your petrological microscope, and let me just bring out the figure of a petrological microscope and its component. So you can see here your condensing lens is there, your primary condensing lens. Okay, But there is another second condensing lens which is called the auxiliary condensing lens or your conoscopic lens. Okay, so in order to obtain the interference figure, we have conoscopic illumination. Okay, you have to remember this. So first you have to bring the microscope in conoscopic illumination. So how we get the conoscopic illumination? It is simple. You just flip in the auxiliary condenser, that is conoscopic lens, and your Bertrand lens. Okay, and then we will observe the interference figure. So your procedure is saying just like that. So flip in the auxiliary condenser, refocus if needed, and open the aperture diagram. Then we cross the polars. Okay, it means that we insert the analyzer. Okay, your removable upper polarizer is called the analyzer, and we insert the analyzer. Okay, and we get cross polar light, that is XPL. So remember that interference figures are always observed under the cross polar light. Then we insert the Bertrand lens or remove the ocular and look down the microscope tube. The image seen with the ocular removed is smaller but somewhat crisper, but instead of an image of the grain, the interference figure consisting of a pattern of interference color and dark band appears near the top surface of the objective lens. Okay, just like that. So you will observe the figure. Now there are different types of interference figures, and this is your optic axis interference figure. Okay, for uniaxial, remember we are talking, this video is about uniaxial interference figure, not biaxial. Biaxial we will discuss in the next video. So the nature of the pattern, that is your pattern, that is the figure's pattern, will depend upon the orientation of the mineral grain, that how the optic axis of a mineral grain is oriented respective to your microscope stage. Okay, so let's first talk about your optic axis interference figure. Okay, why we call it optic axis? So if the optic axis of a mineral grain is perpendicular to the stage, okay, the stage here is microscope stage, we get interference figure which is called optic axis interference figure, and look, it looks like your this figure. Okay, that is black cross with your colored rings. It consists of black cross superimposed on circular band of interference color. The cross is formed of black bars called isogyres, and the point in the center where two isogyres cross is called melotope. Now these melotope, isochrome, isogyres are important. Okay, so you have to remember this figure, because usually in the exam this figure is given and you are made to answer the different structures in this figure. Okay, that is either they will ask what is the isogyre, okay, or either they will ask the isochrome, melotope. It is easy, but it has been asked. Okay, but in I think in the next coming examination it will probably not be asked, because it's very easy, but nonetheless you have to remember these. Okay, now this melotope, the point where two isogyre cross is called the melotope, and the melotope marks the emergence of optic axis. Okay, now optic axis is what I am assuming you know it. Optic axis is the direction along which there is no double refraction. Okay, so light does not reorient along the optic axis. Okay, so the refractive index is only omega. The interference color increased in order outward from the melotope. Okay, so these isochromes are the rings of interference colors. Okay, now this is your typical sketchbook type of figure, but if you look the proper figure which is observed, okay, the real life figure looks something like this. All right, so this is your isogyres, this is your melotope here, and these colored rings are called the isochrome, and they are result of the interference phenomena. And the interference colors increase in outward from the melotope. Okay, so you can see here, this is your first order gray, and there you then there is your first order orange. Okay, and it increases outwards. Okay, the order of interference color. and you can see this, you can check this out by using the Michel Levy chart. Okay, so this is your first order gray, then first order orange, okay, the first order red, first second order green. All right, it looks something like this. So what it means, when I was saying that optic axis of the mineral green is perpendicular to the stage, you can visualize it by using this figure. So this is your typical microscope stage, this is your mineral grain, okay, this rectangular portion, and its optic axis is perpendicular to the microscope stage, okay, and this is your eye. So you're looking down the optic axis, okay. So a question arises that when we are looking down the optic axis, mineral has to be in extinct position, but here we are seeing this phenomena. Okay, why we are seeing this phenomena? It is because of the illumination that we are using, that is the conoscopic illumination. Okay, if we have orthoscopic illumination, the mineral will remain extinct. Okay, and due to this conoscopic illumination, we get the interference figure. Okay, now how we get it, we will discuss. So this is your basic about optic axis interference figure. Remember, in optic axis interference figure, the optic axis of a mineral is perpendicular to the microscope stage. Okay, what is a microscope stage? You can see here, this is your microscope stage. Okay, and the optic axis is perpendicular to it. Okay, now let's talk about how isochromes are formed. So the isochrome's formation is illustrated in the figure here. Okay, and the auxiliary condenser of the substage provide strongly convergent light that passes through the mineral and is collected by the objective lens. Now in orthoscopic illumination, your typical basic orthoscopic illumination, there is no second condensing lens. Okay, so the light is not strongly convergent, but here when we add the conoscopic lens, that is the secondary condenser, the light is strongly convergent. Okay, and this is the reason why we get the interference figure and not the extinction position. So here you can see the light following path 1, here is the path 1, is parallel to the optic axis. Okay, so this line you see here, we can call it optic axis. Okay, and this ray of light is parallel to the optic axis, right? It is not split into two rays. Okay, so this ray is not split into two rays because it is parallel to the optic axis, right? And exit the mandrels with zero retardation to form the melatope. So here your melatope is formed. Light following path 2 experiences moderate retardation because the value of E dash is close to an omega. Now this second, due to the convergence property of the auxiliary condenser, experiences retardation here, okay, because it is somewhat angle incident to the optic axis and not parallel, right? And due to that, it gets the retardation, okay, delta. And when it gets the retardation, it means it has a birefringence. It means the ray is split into two rays, okay, E rays and O rays, right? But the refractive index of the second ray here is close to the omega. Okay, the omega is this one, that is the first one, right? Because obviously it is closer, this ray is closer to the first ray, and that's why it experiences a moderate retardation. But light following the path 3 at a greater angle to the optic axis, so you can see this light 3, ray 3 is at a greater angle to the optic axis, encounters high birefringence and must traverse a longer path. So you know the retardation is a property of thickness into birefringence, right? Thickness here represent the path which is traversed by the light rays. Okay, so you know the thickness depends birefringence depends upon the thickness, depends upon the thickness and the birefringence, right? So if the thickness is high, birefringence will be high too. So the ray third has a greater retardation, okay? But because the optic axis is vertical and the optical properties are symmetric about the optic axis, rings of equal retardation are produced. Okay, so you have to remember this, because in this direction optic properties are symmetrical. So the rings which we get will have equal retardation, okay, are produced about the melato. So again you can see here, this is your relatable figure. So condenser is condensing the rays, okay, and remember this condenser is the second condenser, that is the auxiliary condenser or a conoscopic lens, okay. There is a first condenser here too, and it is strongly convergent, and this is how your optic axis interference figure is formed, and this is the projection, okay. We observe it like this. Now these isochrome are of equal retardation due to the fact that along this optic axis the optical properties of mineral are symmetrical. So the number of isochrome visible within the field of view depends upon the birefringence and thickness of the sample. Okay, so if the sample is thick and it has high birefringence, the number of isochrome will be high. Okay, and suppose if it's a quartz, the number of isochrome will be low. But if it's a calcite, which is a highly birefringent mineral, the isochrome numbers will be high. Okay. Okay, so samples that are thick or that have high birefringence show more isochrome than thin or low birefringence sample. And each and every line that I am saying is very important, because questions can be formed in any way. Okay, they might ask that they might ask the number of isochrome, that how the thickness is related to the number of isochromes, or birefringence is related to number of isochromes. Okay. So the number of isochromes depends upon three things. First is your birefringence, second is your thickness, and third is the numerical aperture of your objective lens. Okay, so what is numerical aperture? Go see my petrological video. I have talked about the numerical aperture of objective lens. Okay, so the numerical aperture of objective lens also determine the number of isochrome that we see. Okay, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, something like that. And remember, the interference order of the color increases from the melatope. Okay, so first order, second order, third order, something like that. So numerical aperture is what you can watch my video on petrological microscope. There I have discussed it. So here you can see, you might be wondering that why these the incident which are angular to the optic axis are not showing the double refraction in the image. Okay, each ray that enters the mineral is split into two rays, okay, except the ray which is parallel to the optic axis. But अगर हम दो रेज यहाँ पे बनाएंगे तो डायग्राम जो है काफी क्लस्टर्ड हो जाएगा. सो दैट्स वाई वी आर नॉट शोइंग द टू रेज हियर. ओके, इट वुड क्लटर द डायग्राम. ओके, बट रिमेंबर ऑल दीज रेज, दैट इज दिस रे विच आर मेकिंग द आइसोक्रोम्स आर इनफैक्ट doubly refracted. Okay, so there are O rays and E rays too. So this was all about isochromes, that how isochromes are formed. Now formation of isogyres. So that how isogyres are formed. So isogyres are formed where the vibration directions in the interference figures correspond to the vibration direction of the lower and upper polars. Okay, so isogyres are in fact the areas of extinction. Okay, so these isogyres are the areas of extinction. Okay, and along these isogyres, the vibration direction of your upper polar or lower polar correspond to the vibration direction of your interference figure. Okay, so let us just see the figure A. So this is your figure A. Okay, this is your figure A, and in figure A, vibration direction of the light that pierces the uniaxial positive indicatrix of the mineral. So this is your positive indicatrix. Okay, so the prolate ellipse is your positive uniaxial. Okay, so here the example of positive uniaxial indicatrix is given. Now light is piercing through this positive uniaxial indicatrix, and ordinary rays vibrate parallel to the line, analogous to the lines of latitude. Now why the light enters the mineral, the ordinary ray are vibrating parallel to the latitudes. Okay, remember, and the this is the extraordinary ray latitude, that would be in horizontal direction. Okay, so light is vibrating in horizontal direction, and that is for the omega ray, and E ray is vibrating longitudinal. Okay, now okay, longitudinal. The vibration direction of the strongly convergent light passing through the mineral plate in figure can be projected into the interference figure. The extraordinary ray vibrate along the radial lines like that spoke on the wheel, and the ordinary ray vibrate tangent to the circular isochrome. So if polars are crossed, isogyres from where the vibration direction of the figure are parallel to the vibration direction of the polars. So what it means is that you have your this is your uniaxial mineral. Okay, and when the incident light, which is angular to the optic axis, travel through this uniaxial mineral, it is split into two rays, that is O rays and E rays. O ray and E ray. Now vibration direction of these rays are important. Okay, so how these rays are vibrating? The E ray is vibrating longitudinal, okay, and O ray is vibrating latitudinal. Now if we, as you can see here, okay, now if we project this vibration direction onto the interference figure, we get something like this. Okay, so this is important, remember this, because it will be helpful in determining the optic sign or the sign of elongation. Now remember, the E ray in the interference figure, optic axis interference figure of uniaxial mineral, the E ray is vibrating radially. Okay, so it means radially like this, and O ray is vibrating tangentially. Okay, as you can see here, these are the isogyres. Here it is not painted black, but when the vibration direction of these two rays correspond to the vibration direction of either lower polar or the upper polar, they go black. But here at the 45 degree, they are not parallel to the vibration direction of lower or upper polar, and hence we get the isochrome figures. So remember, omega is tangential and E ray is radial. Okay, so you can remember the vibration direction of these two rays by a mnemonic called VITTI. Okay, VITTI is, for W you have omega, I is tangential to isochrome. Okay, so if you remember this one, you will all automatically will remember the E rays. Okay, so if omega is tangential to isochrome, the E ray will be radial to the figure. Now how we will use this information in the next topic is like this. So there are other optic axis interference figure for uniaxial, first, second. So we have already discussed the main one, that is the optic axis. There is a second one, off center optic axis. So this is nothing but the optic axis is off center. Okay, so here a figure, your typical optic axis interference figure. You can see the optic axis, this red line is perpendicular to the stage. In off center optic axis, that is B, the optic axis is not perpendicular to the stage but at an angle. Okay, so you get a off center optic axis figure. Okay, so off center optic axis figure looks like this, whose center is not present here. Okay, so it is off center. So isojar stay centered on the meratope and retain their essentially north south and east west orientation. Okay, so as the stage is rotated, the meratope sweeps around the field of view. Okay, so meratope will sweep around like this. Okay, but the isojar will stay centered on the meratope. Okay, so isojar will have position like that only the meratope will move. Okay, if we rotate the microscope stage for the off center optic axis. And then there is your flash figure. Okay, so the mineral grain is oriented with optic axis horizontal to the microscope stage. Okay, so this is your microscope stage, this is your mineral, and this is your optic axis of the mineral. So we will get the flash figure. Okay, so question can be asked that how we get the optic uniaxial optic axis flash figure. So we get it when the optic axis is horizontal to the microscope stage. Okay, and it is called the flash figure or the optic normal figure. Okay, so you have to remember both terms, optic flash figure or the optic normal figure. Okay, and the optic axis is horizontal to the microscope stage, and in the optic axis uniaxial figure, your optic axis was perpendicular to the microscope stage, and in off center optic axis, your optic axis is at an angle to the microscope stage. Okay, so there are essentially three interference figure. So the vibration direction throughout the field of view are nearly parallel. The E rays, so because the optic axis is horizontal to the microscope stage, the vibration direction will remain nearly parallel to the when throughout the field of view. The E rays vibrate approximately parallel to the trace of optic axis. Yes, okay, so we do know that the E rays always vibrate parallel to the optic axis or the C axis of uniaxial mineral. Okay, I have discussed that in my previous video. And the omega rays will vibrate perpendicular to the optic axis. This is your fundamental knowledge. So if the grain is oriented so that the optic axis is either north south or east west, most of the field of view will be occupied by broad fuzzy isojars. Okay, so if optic axis is either north south or east west, the isojars will be broad and fuzzy. As you can see here, this D1 is your optic normal or flash figure. Okay, so here you can see the isojars are not sharp, they are fuzzy. Okay. Now, if the stage is rotated a small amount, that is less than 5 degree, the isojar quickly split and move out of the field of view in opposite quadrant corresponding to the quadrant in which optic axis is being moved. Okay, so if we rotate slightly, these isojar will quickly move away from each other, okay, and they will be out of the field of view. As you can see here, there is no isojars. When the optic axis is placed in 45 degree position, the entire field of view is occupied by interference colors and isochromes are concave outward. Okay, so at 45 degree position, when the stage is rotated, you get figure like this and the isojars are concave outwards. Sorry, isochromes are concave outwards. Okay, so these are your isochromes and they are broad and fuzzy. The quadrants that contain the optic axis, the color decreases away from the center because the birefringence for the inclined ray is less than for rays passing at the right angle to the optic axis. In the remaining quadrants, the interference color increases away from the center. Okay, so the quadrants which are containing the optic axis, take a look at this figure here. So this is your at 45 degree. Okay, so at 45 degree, what you will see is that this is your optic axis, which is horizontal, right? So that's why we are getting this orientation. Now, optic axis is present in two quadrants. Okay, this and this, right? That is first, second and third quadrant. So the in those quadrants where optic axis is there, the colors decreases away from the center. Okay, so the colors will be here, the colors will be of high order. Okay, it means close to the center, the color will be of higher order. Secondly, low order. Thirdly, very low order. Okay, so you can say third order, second order, first order. Again, third order, second order, first order. Okay, now those quadrants where optic axis is not present, okay, the interference color decreases away from the center. So here the optic axis is not present, the interference color will be decreasing away from the center. Okay, sorry, increasing away from the center. Okay, I might have wrongly interpret that. So forget that one. Here the opposite is happening. Okay, so the interference color is increasing away from the center. So here you will have low order interference color and here higher order, here higher order. Okay, so you have to remember this portion. Again, if you are getting confused, again I will just clarify it. Here the flash figure is at 45 degree position. The quadrants which are containing the optic axis, okay, the colors will decrease away from the center. So it means at the center you will have higher order color, okay, then lower order, then again very low order. Okay, so suppose you can take an example. Here your fourth order pink, okay, here is your third order red, okay, second order red, something like this, and here opposite will happen. Okay, here will be your low order first, then higher order, then a higher order. Okay, so this was all about your flash figures. Then let's talk about the accessory plates, because in order to explain the sign of elongation and the determination of optic axis, we have to talk about the accessory plate, or they are also called the compensators. Okay, so a slot is provided immediately above the objective lens for accessory plates. Okay, so if you look at this diagram here, so above your objective lens there is a slot provided for your accessory plates. Okay, now accessory plates are generally quartz wedge, mica plate or gypsum plate. Okay, now the gypsum plate is also known as one wavelength, okay, one lambda plate or first order red plate, first order red plate. Remember these names because they might be asked in the exams. So the optical element is usually a piece of gypsum or quartz. It's generally gypsum, okay, ground to precise thickness and mounted between two pieces of glass. Depending upon the manufacturer, it may be masked gyps wrought one quartz sensitive tint. The way these are all the names of your gypsum plate. Okay, so the retardation which gypsum plate provides is of 537 nanometer. Okay, so it has a constant retardation. The mica plate is known as quarter wavelength plate, okay, 1/4 lambda plate, consists of piece of muscovite that is mounted between two pieces of glass, just like gypsum plate. Okay, so the glimmer is a famous name for mica plate. Okay, glimmer, because in German mica is called glimmer. Okay, and it has retardation, low retardation of 147 nanometer. Okay, now why this retardation is used, we will discuss it. Okay, what is the importance of this retardation? The quartz wedge in its simplest form is a piece of quartz ground into wedge shape and cemented between two pieces of glass. Okay, so quartz wedge is a wedge shape, right? And the other two accessory plates are normally shaped. It means they have constant thickness all over their length. But in quartz wedge, the thickness is variable. Okay, so here you are. Is your typical examples. So this is your first order red plate. Okay, so this is your first order red plate. This is your quartz wedge. Okay, this is the vibration direction of the slow and fast rays of the accessory plates. Okay, and this is your quartz wedge. Its cross section looks like this, like a wedge. Okay, and this is your slow direction is marked. Slow vibration direction is marked on the accessory plates. Okay, in all the accessory plates, this slow vibration direction is marked. Okay, like this. Now, quartz wedge, due to its variable thickness, have different orders of retardation. Okay, so third order red, first order red. If the thickness is very low, the retardation will be of first order. Okay, why I am calling the order? Because retardation is essentially the lambda. And lambda is essentially your color. Okay, remember this, all these are related to your interference video that I have made. So wait, okay, sorry about the interruption. So this is your basic of accessory plates. Okay, now we will talk about the sign of elongation. What is sign of elongation? So some anisotropic crystals have prismatic habit. Okay, it means they are prism like okay, something like this. And why they have prismatic habit? Because when we are talking about uniaxial, the crystal systems are hexagonal and tetragonal, and these hexagonal and tetragonals have prismatic habits. Okay, so usually these uniaxial minerals are break into elongated fragments. Okay, that means in lengthwise or prismatic fashion. The polarized light passing through an anisotropic prismatic crystals with polarization parallel to the long dimension will not travel at the same velocity as light polarized in other direction. This distinction allows the prismatic minerals to be divided into two sign of elongation, length fast or length slow. Simply, we know that these uniaxial minerals are doubly refractive. So, कहने का मतलब यह है कि length fast It means nothing. It means the fast ray is vibrating along the length of that mineral, right? So vibration direction is something like this. Length slow means that slower light is vibrating along the long dimension. Okay, slow light, fast light or fast ray. Sign of elongation cannot be determined on anisotropic crystals that cleave to produce equidimensional fragments. So if we have equidimensional fragments, we don't have sign of elongation. Okay, so sign of elongation for tetragonal and hexagonal crystals is simpler. Okay, so why it is simpler? Because prismatic haptid is more common in these two minerals. Okay, so automatically the uniaxial minerals, the sign of elongation for uniaxial minerals is simpler, but for triclinic, orthorhombic and monoclinic minerals, which are biaxial minerals, it is very hard to find because we generally don't get the prismatic habits, or you would say the mineral don't cleave into long dimensions. Okay, so this thing you have to remember. Now the first order red accessory plate or 550 nanometer, now here it is 550 nanometer, it can be 537 nanometer. Okay, two things are given, two types of retardation are given, so you can either use 550 or 537. Okay, 537 is given in William Dines, so, and this is of Tulane University. So first order red compensator or accessory plate can be used to determine the fast and slow direction in a crystal. Okay, so now we will see that how we determine the fast and slow direction. To do this, the crystal must be aligned on the microscope stage with one of its privileged direction oriented 45 degree to the polarizing direction of the microscope. Okay, so what it means is that the privileged direction means the vibration direction of the slow ray or the fast ray. Okay, so the vibration direction of the slow ray or fast ray must be oriented 45 degree to the polarizing direction of the microscope. Okay, why 45 degree? Because at 45 degree we get the maximum interference. Okay, so here we will consider the both cases, that is slow and fast. So let's talk about the slow direction. Okay, that how we get the slow direction. Now slow direction means that high RI direction. Okay, again I am saying, visualize the speed or velocity of light related to the refractive index. Okay, so if it's a slow light, automatically the RI will be high. Okay, since refractive index of a mineral is velocity of light in vacuum upon velocity of light in that mineral. Okay, so if velocity of light in that mineral is slow, it is inversely proportional to RI, so we will get high RI. Okay, so in crystal parallel to the slow direction in the compensator. Okay, so we have to find the slow direction, okay, which is parallel to the slow direction in the compensator. Imagine that the crystal produces, now let's imagine a scenario where crystal is producing 100 nanometer of retardation. Okay, retardation is delta is equal to T into birefringence. Okay, birefringence is what? Maximum difference between the two refractive indices of anisotropic mineral. Now let's say a mineral is producing 100 nanometer of retardation. This would correspond to the first order gray interference color, right? So if you look at the Michel-Levy chart, a 100 nanometer of retardation would correspond to the first order gray. Okay, so this is your first order gray interference color with analyzer inserted. Already we have XPL. Okay, now we will insert the accessory plate with its slow direction parallel to the slow direction in the crystal. Sorry, parallel to the slow direction in the crystal. So it will produce an additional 550 nanometer of retardation, right? So कहने का मतलब क्या है कि let's take an example of this. Okay, so this is your first example. So you have a crystal and your slow direction is this one, right? So your slow ray is vibrating in this direction. Now first order gray color is happening due to the retardation, right? Now we insert the accessory plate here and its slow direction is also parallel to the slow direction of your mineral, right? Now since slow and slow direction are parallel to each other, the retardation will add, right? Because this will have a retardation of 550 or 537 nanometer and this have a retardation of 100 nanometer and both are slow rays, so they will add. Okay, so they will lag additionally 650 nanometer, right? Because both slow, remember in accessory plate your slow direction is marked, okay? So this is your slow direction. Now they are both parallel to each other and they will create an additional retardation of 650 nanometer, okay? That is the 550 nanometer of accessory plate plus 100 nanometer of your hypothetical crystal. Now we will get the retardation of 650 nanometer. Now 650 nanometer correspond to which interference color? We can see it in the Michel-Levy chart. So here is your retardation, this is your 650 nanometer and this is your blue color. And which order? This is your second order blue color, okay? So we will get, after inserting the accessory plate, a second order color, blue color, okay? And we will say that a mineral is length slow, right? So mineral will be called length slow. So here you can see a mineral has a first order gray, the slow light is vibrating along the length. You insert an accessory plate and additional retardation happens and we get a second order blue. Okay, so it looks something like this. And the grain will be called length slow. Similarly, we will use the fast direction. And in fast direction, the crystal is parallel to the fast direction of the crystal is parallel to the slow direction of the compensator. So again, we have a 100 nanometer retardation and we are using 100 nanometer hypothetically, okay? And we insert the accessory plate, but in this case a mineral is the fast ray is vibrating along the length of a mineral, okay? Now we insert the accessory plate and we have a vibration direction fast here and we have a vibration direction slow here, right? Now what will happen? Look at this. So here you have already slow, okay? Its orientation will not change, the accessory plates, but here now we have a fast ray instead of slow ray. Now what will happen? The fast wave will be slowed down and the previous slow wave will have overtaken it by the 450 nanometer. Okay, so subtraction will happen, right? Because why subtraction happens? Because we know the accessory plate has 550 nanometer of retardation and here the sorry I'm using the wrong diagram. So here the accessory plate has 550 nanometer of retardation, and here we have fast ray. So it means that this fast ray is already 100 nanometer faster, right? Or 100 nanometer ahead of the slow ray. So this retardation will make nanometer of retardation when they combine, because 100 nanometer will be subtracted from this one. So we will get a retardation of what? Yellow, and the grain will be called length fast. Okay, because the fast ray is vibrating along the length. So if you get a yellow color, we will see that in Michel-Levy chart, the first order yellow color is here. Sorry, 450 nanometer is something here, and we are getting the first order yellow, or you could say the orange. Okay, so in some textbook this is called first order orange, and in some textbook they call it first order yellow, right? So example, as you can see here, okay, so this is your length fast crystal. Now remember, we can also determine the optic sign from this phenomena too. Okay, how we can determine? We know that E ray vibrates along the C axis of uniaxial Mendrus, right? That is tetragonal or hexagonal Mendrus. Now this C axis is parallel to the optic axis of those Mendrus, right? Now optic axis is generally along the length, right, or along the C axis. So we know that E ray vibrates along the length, right? So if a mineral is length fast, it means that E ray is your fast ray, right? Because we know that E ray is vibrating along the length, and length is your C axis. Now if E ray is fast ray, we know that pole and gnome, what is that? This is your mnemonic for remembering the uniaxial positive or uniaxial negative Mendel. So if E ray is fast, it means that negative, if we talk about this one, negative if omega is more than E, and omega refractive index will be more than E when omega is the slow ray and E is the fast ray. So if E is the fast ray, what will happen? We will have a length fast mineral, and we will get a first order yellow or first order orange. Okay, so by this we can obtain your uniaxial positive or negative sign. Okay, but remember, for sign of elongation you have to have a mineral which is elongated. Okay, now let's talk about determination of optic sign. So optic sign cannot be determined directly in orthoscopic mode of operation. Okay, so we need conoscopic illumination, except in specific circumstances where the crystal symmetry is known to be high, that is hexagonal, tetragonal, and where crystal shape allows to identify the c-axis direction. Okay, so it means if the sign of elongation can be determined, we can determine the optic sense without the use of conoscopic illumination. Okay, but in the rest cases we need interference figures. So optic sign, we do know that can be identified if ordinary ray is the fast ray or the slow ray. Okay, so if a fast ordinary ray is a fast ray, Mendel is optically positive, that is positive if omega is less than e. Here omega correspond to the refractive index of O ray, and omega will be less than e if O ray is fast ray, right? So we all know this. Now, because the vibration direction of ordinary and extraordinary ray in interference figure are known, so we do know that vibration direction of omega is tangential to isochromes, as you can see here, and for extraordinary ray it is radial to the interference figure. Okay, so we do know that. So if uniaxial interference figure can used easily to determine the optic sign of a Mendel, in such figure there will usually be an area close to the melotope that show the interference color of first order gray. Okay, and then we will insert the accessory plate and observe that what happens to this first order gray. Okay, so the operation is similar to the sign of elongation. Okay, so it is saying that in uniaxial interference figure we know that area close to the melotope will have first order gray, okay, color here, first order gray, and remember this is optic axis figure without plate. Now if we insert the accessory plate, okay, this is your accessory plate, so the Mendel is optically positive if the northeast and southward quadrant of the interference figure turn second order blue. Okay, so these are your northeast and southwest quadrant. Okay, this is your north, this is your east, this is your west, and this is your south. So we do know that this is your slow ray vibration direction. Okay, so slow plus slow, Mendel is optically positive because addition will have occurred in these quadrants. The northwest and southeast quadrant will turn first order yellow or orange. Okay, so in these quadrants subtraction will have occurred. Now how do we know that it is optically positive? Because we do know that E ray is vibrating tangentially, okay, sorry, radially, and omega is vibrating tangential to the isochrome, that means like this. Now if this quadrant is, these two quadrants are having second order blue, it means that E ray is the slow ray, right? Similar to the sign of elongation, E ray will be slow ray, that's why the blue is coming out, because retardation is there, and here there is less retardation, right? So if E ray is slow ray, it means E refractive index will be greater than the O refractive index, which correspond to the optical positive, that is pole positive, omega less than E. Okay, so omega is less than E, so we get a positive Mendel. Okay, so in real life image you see what happens? Okay, so blue here, blue here. So you have an optical positive mineral. Okay, so sometimes it is very hard to remember, not very hard, but it get confusing for the students with the how we remember this figure. So one easy way, easy trick to remember this figure is, if one remember where yellow colors occurs, note that drawing a line connecting the yellow quadrants would cross the slow direction in the compensator like a plus sign. Okay, vertical stroke in the plus sign. So what is trying to say, I hope it is clear that how we get optically positive and optically negative, okay, using the retardation. So what is trying to say is that, I hope it is clear that how we get this optical sign. This E ray is vibrating tangent radially. Okay, so if E ray is a slow ray, we will get additional retardation, we will get second order blue. Okay, that is 550 plus 100 nanometer, 650 nanometer, we get second order blue, that is higher order color. It means E ray is the slow ray, it means E ray has higher refractive index than the O ray. Okay, and we have an optical positive mineral. But how we remember it? Either you can remember the quadrants where the higher order interference color is happening, or you can remember the yellow color. Okay, and if you remember the yellow color is where we can draw a line. Okay, now look at this. This is your slow vibration direction of an accessory plate, and if you draw the line from yellow, we get a positive sign. Okay, so you can remember like this. Now here is one thing for low birefringent crystals like quartz, first order gypsum plate or first order red plate is used. Okay, remember this, instead of quartz wedge. But for high birefringent crystal, quartz wedge is used. Okay, instead of first order gypsum plate. Okay, this is important point. And we do note that the high birefringent crystals have multiple isochromes. Okay, because isochrome depends upon thickness, birefringence and numerical aperture. The numerical aperture thickness is generally same for all minerals. So birefringence is variable, and birefringence correspond to the higher number of isochromes. Okay, so as you can see here, this is your calcite, and it has very high number of isochromes. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, something like this. And for quartz, you have very low number of isochromes. Okay, so similar thing happens for high birefringence crystals. If you insert the accessory plate, you will have for positive sign, you will have blue color here, yellow color here, and the isochrome seems to move in this way. Okay, and for negative, like calcite is a negative crystal, optically negative. Okay, so you have blue here and negative here. Okay, sorry, blue here and yellow here. So for negative crystals, let's say what happens. So if the mineral is optically negative, the northeast and southwest quadrants of the interference figure turn first degree yellow. Okay, so vice versa happens. And why this happens? So we do know that E ray is vibrating radially. So if E ray is the fast ray, the retardation will be less. Okay, so 550 minus 100, 450, which correspond to the first order yellow. So if E ray is a fast ray, then Ri of E will be less than Ri of O. And if E is less than Ri of O, we get optically negative mineral, right? Okay, so how you can remember this? Again, you can remember this figure using where the yellow is happening. Okay, yellow color is happening. So again, Draw a line and bisect the yellow quadrants. And what sign it is making with the slow ray? It is making a negative sign. Okay, so connect the yellow quadrants would be parallel to the slow direction in the compensator, like the single stroke on a minus sign. Okay, so I think it is easy in this way to remember the optically uniaxial optically positive figure and negative figure. Okay, make a bisect the yellow quadrants and it will bisect the slow direction of accessory plate. Okay, and it will make the plus sign. But the procedure you have to remember. Okay, and in negative just bisect the quadrants where yellow color is present and compare it to the slow ray of accessory plate and you see the minus sign. Okay, it looks like a minus sign. So this is for your determination of optic sign. So I hope it is clear that how we determine the optic sign and how the sign of elongation can also be used to determination of optic sign. So I have cleared all the topics very well, and in next topic we will talk about the biaxial interference figures. Okay, that how we use the 2V angle, how the positive and negative is determined, right? So thank you for watching. That's it for today's video, and if there are some disturbance in the background, just ignore it, and don't forget to comment down below your thoughts. Thank you.